be encouraged. There is ample reason that we rejoice in every season. If we surrender to the Holy Spirit and let Him lead us by the hand through the Scriptures, we will live a victorious life in this present season that includes pain and suffering and trials. In the Word of God, we find hope, we find the promises of God, we find the face of God through the Holy Spirit who leads us and guides us and reads to us this inspired Word. So that's my prayer right now, Holy Spirit, that you open up the Scriptures to us, that you feed us with bread from heaven. Jesus Christ Himself in Scripture form, feed our souls, strengthen us so that we are full with the revelation of Jesus. Today I want to speak about the eternal perspective. And this is something that is often on my heart, is to take our eyes off our present day problems and lift our eyes to see the great and grand plan of God's salvation. Often when we do that small posture, that posture of heart that takes our eyes off the small season of suffering and looks up to the great mystery that is unfolding, which is God adopting a family through the blood of His Son. And this family will again be resurrected in newness of life and body to rule and reign with God forever in a new created earth. When we have that perspective, when we see the weight of eternity, the problems of today come into perspective and they seem very small and borderline insignificant in the weight and light of eternity. I want to turn to a passage that's just been on my heart this week. Let's just read and pray the Holy Spirit lead us and feed us with the Word. I'm reading 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50 through 58. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Every blood-bought believer has grounds, eternal grounds to rejoice, for we have inherited something that our flesh and blood could never, and that is reconciliation with God. The fall of man has been restored through the blood covenant of Jesus, His shed blood and broken body that has now restored and reconciled union between Creator and creation, God and man. So let us boast, let us glory, let us rejoice in that fact. It's a miracle that we stand before God and one with God in spirit by the blood of Christ. It is not the doing of our own flesh or our own blood. It is only because of the blood of Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the miracle of salvation. Thank you that your body and your blood could do what we could never, and that is restore and reconcile that fallen relationship between Creator and creation. Nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. There is no death in divine love. Salvation gives us the gift of eternal life, but that cannot be separated from the person of Jesus. We do not receive eternal life for ourselves, that we live forever. We receive eternal life unto somebody else, unto Jesus. Divine love has no death. So if we become one with Christ, in spirit. If we are truly going to be married to Him, we need to have the same caliber of love, divine love. And divine love has no death in it. There is not a stench of sin within it. It is pure. It is holy. So understand that salvation is unto a greater privilege, which is to love the Lord with His love, divine love that knows no death. But our love on earth, fallen man's love knows death. If we look at the world around us, all we see is death. Everything lives and dies, lives and dies, lives and dies. So we need to put on the garments of imperishable love to love the Lord rightly, because He deserves a caliber of love that He gives, and that's eternal love, free from all rebellion, free from all sin, free from all evil. And that's the love of man. We need the love of God to love God. So we need to put on the imperishable. The perishable must dissolve, and the imperishable must become our forever garments. If you can understand that picture. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable. And we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable. And this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then it shall come to pass. This saying, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? So this is talking about the return of Jesus Christ. And when we see Him, when we gather in the clouds with all the saints, we will become like Him. We will receive our full inheritance, and that is our glorified bodies. And in that moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet blast, we will be like Jesus. This prophetic promise will become a reality. We will receive our glorified bodies. We will sound like Him in voice. We will shine like Him in splendor. And our face will be as radiant as Him. We will be dressed in righteous whites, like the one who ransomed and redeemed us and has now come to retrieve us. This promise, beloved, you should sit on your heart and think about it often. This is the victory where death is swallowed up, where sin, where the presence of sin is forever ripped away from our hearts. In that day, we will be like the Lord and love the Lord in the way that He deserves. Jesus will get His reward for Calvary. He will see a bride that is like Him. He will present to Himself a purified, precious bride that looks like Him and loves like Him. Divine love has no death in it. And in that day, Christ will experience the fullness of this promise. We will experience the fullness of our inheritance in the family of God and being adopted as sons and daughters in God's family. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. Those who have put their faith in Jesus Christ, the rescue of mankind, those who have put their faith in the blood of Jesus, in the broken body of Jesus, in His death at Calvary, in His resurrection, in His ascension, in His glorification, who have put their faith in the gospel, the saving gospel, they will never die. No, if they die before the return of Christ, they just sleep. Like the saints of old, they are sleeping. And this describes a spiritual sense of waiting for the fullness of redemption. The saint will never die. Our soul will never find corruption in Sheol. No, just like Jesus, we will not see corruption. We have been redeemed from the pit, from the grave, and death has no grip over us. Death has no victory from us. We can dance in the grave, for we have a new destination, and our destination is life eternal through the blood of Christ. But we wait for the day of his return and the resurrection of the dead into a glorious new season of ruling and reigning with Jesus in our glorified bodies. Oh, we should be yearning and groaning with creation. Romans 8:22. All of creation groans, deep groanings for let us turn there. It's too rich. Romans 8:22. Let's go from 20. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, grown inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. Here it is. Creation is groaning. The earth is growing, and can I say the cloud of witnesses, the saints that have gone before us who are in spiritual sleep, not meaning they are sleeping, but that's their spiritual state. They are also awaiting this day of resurrection where they will receive their glorified bodies. And we should be groaning in prayer for this. Come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. Let us receive our bodies so that we can love you in a high caliber, in a caliber that you deserve. May divine love love divinity. We don't like the presence of sin in our offering of love to you. Redeem us, retrieve us, transform us in a twinkling of an eye so that we can receive our glorified bodies and love you rightly. That is eternal life. John 17, in the high priestly prayer in the beginning where it says that eternal life is to know the Father. So the Lord is bringing us into knowing him. And when we know him, we love him. As we have a deeper revelation of him, so deep worship will flow forth. Understand, we are saved unto a greater privilege, and that is eternal worship and adoration of King Jesus. We are saved unto a greater another, and that's King Jesus. We are in a season where divine love must be tested. Let us yield to the Holy Spirit and make costly decisions of sacrificial love. Let us boldly step out in faith. Let us still proclaim in seasons of darkness and suffering that the Lord is good. Though we haven't got our full breakthrough, though we are not in the fullness of redemption, let us cry out in faith and in boldness and in conviction. Lord, we love you. You are good. You are healer. You are Lord. You are our leader. And though sometimes our circumstances will roar against that and say opposite, we believe the word. We are children of the wind who believe the Lord. We are children led by the Spirit who believe the scriptures. And the scriptures point to Jesus, and it engulfs our heart with excitement for his return. And when we will receive this glorified body, oh death, where is your sting? Oh death, you have been swallowed up in the victory of Christ's redemptive work and love. The grave is empty, saying we can dance in the grave, for we have received the resurrected life of Jesus Christ. We have put on the righteousness of Jesus Christ, and we are eternal beings right now. We have been grafted into the glory of the Godhead, and eternity has started. But like the saints who have fallen asleep before us, and those who die before the return of Jesus, we all groan. Come, Lord Jesus, come, Lord Jesus, come, Lord Jesus, so that the fullness of our inheritance may come, and that the fullness of your reward will be given to you. Oh, Holy Spirit, prepare us and present us to Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Oh, you have our heart, Jesus. You have our heart. We just yield to the work of redemption and sanctification. And we look with eagerness to your return. We look with eagerness and we thank you that you have defeated the grave, that death has no grip over us. We love the victorious life in your resurrected life. Thank you that you are the first who is raised from the dead, and there will be many after you who follow in your footsteps of resurrected life in a glorified body, who will then walk together ruling and reigning in perfected love for eternity. Bless your name, Jesus. Amen.